yeah, it's still a lot of debate about who we are. Cass Organ, we ain't African, we ain't black, we ain't this, we ain't that. Man, truth is, we all of that. Because all of that comes from us, you know what I'm saying? It's all about where you gonna fit in. Yeah. Yo, yo, what's your name? You an African, an American, or an Israelite? Black or more, Muhammad or a provocateur, what the business like? Yeah. You Malcolm X, my enemy. Yeah. Cheek Turner, Dr. King, yeah. Keep a burner, you repeat. Yeah. Look at me, who you see? I'm Barbie when I rap a bar. Every line is a black star. I'm Master Far because I understand who these crackers are. Nat Turner's my avatar. Yeah. My attitude so desolate. I'm a mocking dog, these motherfuckers. Dr. Cox, these Europeans know what I mean. I'm Farrakhan, never will I run. Robert Williams, nigga with a gun. George and Jonathan Jackson, Dr. Joseph Ben, Dr. Nam, showing proof like Dr. Clark. I'm a goon cause I got the heart. I'm Dubois cause I'm hella smart. I'm this L cause I got the part. I'm Bianchi, Sutton Khufu, Mansa Musa, Shaka Zulu. I'm a Mia, I'm a Tulu. If I was Jesus, what would you do? I'm a Negro and I'm colored. I'm your nigga and your brother. Yeah, I kill you, but I love you. Accept your own and reject the other. What's your name?
What's your name? And why don't you now know what your name was then? Where did it go? Where did you lose it? Who took it? And how did he get it? What gun did you fit? How did the man take your gun? Where is your history? How did the man wipe out your history? How did the man, what did the man do to make you a gun?
What's your name? It's the Shigaboo, it's the Porsche Monkey, the Sambo. It's the Oreo, maybe revolution is just too much for the handle.
I don't know.
I ain't carry no scandal.
What?
I ain't scary, I am. Harry Tubman with a candle.
What?
Time to pick up the mantle. I'm a son to wop and Queen of Zinga. Never cheating
and Queen of Mina.
Half sister and the Queen of Sheba. She thinks she got, please believe her. Name is Osada's great escape. Angela Davis, keep safe. With a Mandela, refuse break. I'm anime, refuse cake. I see straight through cause I'm late today. Been standing loop, I got things to say. With Shirley Chisholm, I paved the way. The homie queen came to slay. Better survive, I need my Malcolm. Black love is the only outcome.
Yeah.
I won't stop until y'all have some. I might set this shit gon' happen. I'm all shoot, come bless Walter. I'm Nibia, I bless Walter. I'm all the cool, I drive my daughter. I'm all your, I cannot falter. I'm the one to give birth to stars. Masterful, how worth these bars. Series B to the earth tomorrow. KOS, reverse the thought. What's your name?
And why don't you now know what your name was then? Where did you lose it? Who took it? And how did he get it? What gun did you fit? How did the man take your gun? Where is your history? How did the man wipe out your history? How did the man, what did the man do to make you a gun? As you are right now.
Mic check 1 2 1 2. Mic check 1 2 1 2. If you can hear me, let me know in the comments. If you can hear me, let me know in the comments. BIP, Black African Power, Sister Julanda Zachary. How you doing? You know what I'm saying? Peace and power to you. Peace and power to everyone. Wow. Another year has gone by. It is that time of year where we celebrate the birth of a mighty giant in Malcolm X. Elhaj Malik El Shabazz, one of, if not the most influential black leaders in history. You know what I'm saying? In history. Good. I'm glad we loud and clear. Glad we loud and clear. All right. And of course, he was born May 19th, 1925 in Omaha, Nebraska. Would go on to have an impact that has obviously impacted generations and lasted for generations to come. But Malcolm's story for me is also about transformation. His story is also about a growth and courage. Right. And there's so much to unpack with his life, you know, because his life is about us. You know what I'm saying? His life is about black people. And one thing unique about Malcolm's story, and when I study it, is that he was always in tune with what black people, what was going on with black folks. His family was, he came from a family that was in the mix and he was in the mix. You know what I'm saying? He came from an active family and he became active, you know? And so there's so much to unpack in it. But what we're going to do today, this is the Legacy of Malcolm X Part 1. And we're going to watch 1 hour of the documentary Malcolm X Make It Plain. It's a PBS documentary from the 90s about Malcolm's life. And what I love about this documentary is that they talk a lot about his early life, right? About Malcolm the man. A lot of us hear about we hear the quotes by any means necessary and that sort of thing and the work that he did for our people. Of course, we learn a lot about his assassination and the circumstances around his assassination. Right. But how often do we really take time to examine his life? Right. How often do we take time? And a lot of us, you know, because they're not really teaching Malcolm in school. When they teach Malcolm in public school, they're going to teach him like kind of as opposed to Dr. King. Right. And so it's more of a comparative thing, but it's not something that really goes into Malcolm's story. You know what I'm saying? And so this documentary helps us do that. It helps us peel back some layers in the story of Malcolm X, the life of Malcolm X. And there's so much that we can pull out for ourselves and pull out for our youth, you know. And for those of you out there who actively work with young people, by the time a black boy hits ninth grade, he should read the autobiography of Malcolm X. It should be required reading. It's an excellent account of his life, but there's so many life lessons inside of that. And I would like to think that our ancestors, our great leaders, yes, everyone loves being remembered, right? But I think they would prefer that we learn from them, that we study their mistakes, study their successes, study, you know what I'm saying? And study their lives and draw those parallels and draw those life lessons and draw that wisdom out of it as well. So today we're going to begin our study of Malcolm. This is going to be the legacy of Malcolm X, part one. Next Sunday, we'll be back at the same time and we'll watch the remainder of the documentary. And that'll be the legacy of Malcolm X, part two. Hang around, y'all. Hang around after this first hour. I'm going to come back in and I'm going to open the stream yard up. You know what I'm saying? If you have any questions in the comments, you can do that. Thank you, Gail. If you have any questions in the comments about Malcolm or about my opinion about certain things that's going on with black people, just put them in the comments and I'll be happy to answer and address those questions. If you want to know how I feel about anything pertaining to the life of Malcolm X, the assassination of Malcolm, you can definitely put that in the comments as well. But I'm also going to drop the StreamYard link, right? I'm going to drop the StreamYard link into the comments and invite you all to join me after the 1 hour to jump in here and actually join me and jump on this thing. And it'll be a panel, you know. And I know y'all like, well, Bob, I mean, why don't you put out a flyer and why didn't you just invite some people to have a panel? And I could do that. I could do that. And perhaps we will do that one day. But every now and then I just like spontaneously want to share an experience with the community. And I believe that who's supposed to be there is going to be there. And we're all qualified to speak. Right. We're all qualified to speak from now. There's levels to it, but we're all qualified. We all have the right to speak and express what we feel, ask questions and talk. So we're the community. Right. And I just want to hang out with the community today. Those that want to hang out with me, let's check this thing out. Let's get into Malcolm X, Make It Plain. And then we're going to have a brief discussion after 1 hour. We're going to talk about what we saw. And I mean, this thing is good. I mean, we can have a whole discussion after the first 10 minutes, but I'm going to let an hour of this documentary play today and give me y'all feedback. You know what I'm saying? Give me feedback during the broadcast. I would love to do more of these revolutionary films where we view them together and then talk about them and deep dive into them together. So you know, let's do our thing today and honor Malcolm. Let me get it together here. Yeah, and please join the Uhura Academy on Patreon, right? Right? Become a patron. You can be a $25 a month patron, a $5 a month patron, a $100 a month patron. And shout out to all of our patrons out there as well. We definitely appreciate everyone who chooses to give to the Uhura Academy every month. Your donation goes directly into the African Centered Education Movement. So thank you to everyone who is a patron. If you have not joined our Patreon, go join it. All right. Oh, also, before I play the film, I have to tell you all about the UACI STEM Camp. All right, we have the UACI STEM Camp coming up, and I want to share a little bit of information about that with you, and I'm going to come back afterwards to deep dive into it. But basically, the UACI STEM Camp is a collaboration between the Uhuru Academy, which is the UA, right, and Conscious Ingenuity, that's the CI. Right. And Conscious Ingenuity is a STEM program founded by Dr. Oya Mayat, who is an engineering professor at Morgan State University. Right. Oh, and also has that Speak Truth to Power podcast. Right. And well, we've teamed up, and it's our second year doing it. And we do a camp every year where we combine African history with STEM. So I'm going to be telling you a little bit more about the UACI Summer STEM Camp, because we're enrolling right now. Space is limited. We're taking 30 students. So I'll make sure that I get the information to you all, because people are already signing up. You want to get your babies in the UACI STEM Camp this summer. All right. So let's get down to business. Let's get down to business. Oh, and if you want more information about the UACI STEM Camp right now, while the video's playing, just head over to uhuruacademy.com. Head over to uhuruacademy.com. You'll see a link right there on the homepage going to the STEM Camp and pick up more information there. All right. So, hey, let's do this thing. Let's do this thing. And thank you, Gail at Night, for coming in and doing what you do. Y'all make sure that you subscribe to the Gail at Night YouTube channel. Sister be coming with some powerful topics. You know what I'm saying? Some common sense topics too. You know, and that hard conversations that we need to have. You know what I'm saying? So go and subscribe to Gail at Night. Make sure you subscribe and hit the notification button to get notifications. And let's blow Gail at Night up, man. Powerful, powerful sister with some great content. All right. So let's do our thing. Let's do our thing. All right. Boom. Boom. Let's go there. And so y'all see it. And we're going. Here we go, y'all. Malcolm X, Make It Plain. Let me know in the comments if you can hear it and how it's streaming.
And the shape of your lips? Who taught you to hate yourself from the top of your head to the soles of your feet? Who taught you to hate your own kind? Who taught you to hate the race that you belong to? So much so that you don't want to be around each other. No, before you come asking Mr. Muhammad, does he teach hate? You should ask yourself, who taught you to hate being what God gave you?
Most of us blacks, or Negroes as he called us, really thought we were free without being aware that in our subconscious, all those chains we thought had been struck off were still there. And there were many ways where what really motivated us was our desire to be loved by the white man. Malcolm meant to lance that sense of inferiority. He knew it would be painful. He knew that people could kill you because of it, but he dared to take that risk.
He was saying something over and above that of any other leader of that day. While the other leaders were begging for entry into the house of their oppressor, he was telling you to build your own house.
He expelled fear for African Americans. He says, I will speak out loud what we've been thinking. And he said, you'll see. People will hear it, and they will not do anything to us necessarily, okay? But I will now speak it for the masses of people. When he said it in a very strong fashion, in this very manly fashion, in this fashion that says, I am not afraid to say what you've been thinking all these years, that's why we loved him. He said it out loud, not behind closed doors. He took on America for us.
And I, for one, as a Muslim, believe that the white man is intelligent enough. If he were made to realize how black people really feel and how fed up we are without that old compromising sweet talk, why, you're the one that make it hard for yourself. The white man believes you when you go to him with that old sweet talk, because you've been sweet talking him ever since he brought you here. Stop sweet talking. Tell him how you feel. Tell him how, what kind of hell you've been catching, and let him know that if he's not ready to clean his house up, if he's not ready to clean his house up, he shouldn't have a house. It should catch on fire and burn down.
On these Harlem street corners, for most of this century, black people had celebrated their culture and argued the question of race in America. It was here that Malcolm first joined the street orators, who gave voice to Harlem's hope and its anger.
I've taught nationalism, and that means that I want to go out of this white man's country, because integration will never happen. You never, as long as you live, integrate into the white man's system.
125th Street and 7th Avenue was the center of activity among the black street orators. When Malcolm arrived, technically he had no corner. So he established his base, you might say, in front of Elder Mishaw's bookstore.
When Malcolm would ascend the little platform, he couldn't talk for the first 4 or 5 minutes. The people would be making such a praise shout to him. And he would stand there, taking his due. And then he would open his mouth.
They call Mr. Muhammad a hate teacher, because he makes your hate dope and alcohol. They call Mr. Muhammad a black supremacist, because he teaches you and me not only that we're as good as the white man, but better than the white man. Yes, better than the white man. You are better than the white man. And that's not saying anything. That's not saying, you know where just to be equal with him. Who is he to be equal with? You look at his skin. You can't compare your skin with his skin. Why, your skin look like gold beside his skin. There was a time when we used to drool in the mouth over white people. We thought they were pretty because we were blind. We were dumb. We couldn't see them as they are. But since the Honorable Elijah Muhammad has come and taught us the religion of Islam, which has cleaned us up and made us so we can see for ourselves, now we can see that old pale thing to look exactly as he looked. Nothing but an old pale thing.
I came away from that rally feeling that with him, once you heard him speak, you never went back to where you were before. You had to, even if you kept your position, you had to rethink it.
We weren't accustomed to being told that we were devils and that we were oppressors up here in our wonderful northern cities. He was speaking for a silent mass of black people and saying it out front on the devil's own airwaves. And that was an act of war.
When he came off the stage, I jumped off the island, walked up to him. And of course, when I got to him, the bodyguards, you know, moved in front, and he just pushed them away. And I went in front of him and extended my hand and said, I liked some of what you said. I didn't agree with what all that you said, but I liked some of what you said. And he looked at me, held my hand in a very gentle fashion and says, one day you will, sister. One day you will, sister. And he smiled.
To make his message clear, Malcolm used his own life as a lesson for all Black Americans. He preached it in fables and parables. And later, in writing his autobiography with Alex Haley, he sought some control over how his life would be interpreted in the future.
I would be rather taken by a statement he would make of himself. He would say, I am a part of all I have met. And by that, he meant that all the things he had done in his earlier life had exposed him to things, had taught him skills of one another sort of, all of which had synthesized into the Malcolm who became the spokesman for the Nation of Islam.
You were born in Omaha, is that right?
Yes, sir.
And you left, your family left Omaha when you were what, 1 year old?
I imagine about a year old.
And why did they leave Omaha?
Well, to my understanding, the Ku Klux Klan burned down one of their homes in Omaha.
This, they had a lot of Ku Klux Klan. This made your family feel very unhappy, I'm sure.
Well, insecure, if not unhappy.
So you must have a somewhat prejudiced point of view, a personally prejudiced point of view. In other words, you cannot look at this in a broad academic sort of way, really.
I think that's incorrect, because despite the fact that that happened in Omaha, and then when we moved to Lansing, Michigan, our home was burned down again. In fact, my father was killed by the Ku Klux Klan. And despite all of that, no one was more thoroughly integrated with whites than I. No one has lived more so in the society of whites than I.
We were the only Black children in the neighborhood, but on the back of our property, we had a wooded area. So the white kids would all come over to our house and they'd go back and play in the woods. So Malcolm would say, well, let's go play Robin Hood. Well, so we'd go back there to play Robin Hood. Robin Hood was Malcolm. And these white kids would go along with it.
Malcolm said he was the lightest skinned of the seven children born to Earl and Louise Little. A reminder, he said, of the white man who had raped his mother's mother. In 1929, when Malcolm was 4 years old, his father, a carpenter and preacher, moved the family to Lansing, Michigan.
Lansing was a small town, and the west side was the side of town that Blacks lived on. Malcolm and his family lived outside of the city, and they had a 4-acre parcel with a small house on it. So they were sort of considered as farmers.
3 months after the Littles moved in, white neighbors took legal action to evict them. A county judge ruled that the farm property was restricted to whites only. But Earl Little refused to move. Here in Michigan, Ku Klux Klan membership was at least 70,000, five times more than in Mississippi. For Malcolm's family, white hostility was a fact of life.
Everybody was asleep in our house, and all of a sudden we heard a big boom. And when we woke up, fire was everywhere. And everybody was running into the walls and into each other, you know.
Well, what I recall about that was my mother telling us to get up, get up, get up, the house is on fire, and to get out. That's what I actually recall.
I could hear my mother yelling, I hear my father yelling. And so they made sure they got us all rounded up and got us out.
The house burned down to the ground. No fire wagon came, nothing. And we were burned out.
Malcolm's father, Earl Little, accused local whites of setting the fire. The police accused Earl and arrested him on suspicion of arson. The charges were later dropped.
In the city where we grew up, whites would refer to us as those uppity niggers or those smart niggers that live out south of town. In those days, whenever a white person referred to you as a smart nigger, that was their way of saying, this is a nigger you have to watch because he's not dumb.
My father was independent. He didn't want anybody to feed him. He wanted to raise his own food. He didn't want anybody to exercise authority over his children. He wanted to exercise the authority, and he did.
He was always speaking in terms of Marcus Garvey's way of thinking and trying to get black people to organize themselves, not to cause any trouble, but just to work in unity with each other toward improving their conditions. But in those days, if you did that, you were still considered a troublemaker.
In the 1920s, Marcus Garvey, a black nationalist, preached that black Americans should build a nation independent of white society. With membership in the hundreds of thousands, Garvey's Universal Negro Improvement Association sought closer ties with African countries. The UNIA had its own flag, its own national anthem, and an African legion pledged to defend black people at home and abroad. The U.S. Bureau of Investigation labeled Garvey one of the prominent Negro agitators. The federal government deported him in 1927, but Malcolm's parents remained Garveyites. Earl recruited new members. Louise wrote for the Garvey newspaper.
My mother is the one who would read to us the Garvey paper, which was called The Negro World. And she also would talk to us about ourselves as being independent. We shouldn't be calling ourselves Negroes or niggers, and that we were black people, and that we should be proud to call ourselves black people.
What is your real name?
Malcolm. Malcolm X.
Is that your legal name?
As far as I'm concerned, it's my legal name.
Would you mind telling me what your father's last name was?
My father didn't know his last name. My father got his last name from his grandfather, and his grandfather got it from his grandfather, who got it from the slave master. The real names of our people were destroyed during slavery.
Was there any point in the genealogy of your family when you did have to use the last name? And if so, what was it?
The last name of my forefathers was taken from them when they were brought to America and made slaves. And then the name of the slave master was given, which we refuse. We reject that name today.
You mean you won't even tell me what your father's supposed last name was or gifted last name was?
I never acknowledge it whatsoever.
September 1931, Malcolm was 6 years old when his mother had a premonition.
We were all at the house and we had dinner, supper together. And my mother was holding Wesley, who was my youngest brother. And she may have been nursing him because she was at the table and she fell asleep, nursing, holding the baby. And my father had gotten up and went in the bedroom to clean up, to go down and collect money. And she woke up and she said, Earl, don't go downtown. She said, if you go, you won't come back.
That night, around 11 o'clock, Earl Little was found in an isolated area outside Lansing. His body almost cut in two by the wheels of a streetcar. The police reported Earl Little's death an accident.
There was a cloud over that whole issue. Because at the time, it was perceived that rather than an accident with a streetcar, that Earl Little had really been pushed under the wheels of the streetcar. As a matter of fact, I remember hearing just that language, that he was probably pushed under the wheels of that streetcar.
My father's death caused a great, great shock in the family. Because he was the power. He was the strength. We were organized. We were a structured family. When we got out of school, me and my brothers and sisters, we'd come right home and go to work in the garden, clean up the chicken shed and get ready for the night and get up in the morning and all this. We'd pump the water and bring it in the house and all this. This was while Dad was alive, because to not do this brought the consequence of a whipping. So we were disciplined. And then after my father got killed and my mother's inability to run as fast as I could run, or Malcolm, enabled us to get away with a lot of things we wouldn't have tried to get away with. So we got looser and looser.
Louise Little struggled to raise her seven children through the years of the Great Depression.
She's reduced to where she has no income. She'd try to get, she got jobs. She did. She was a proud lady. She had a lot of pride. She sewed. She crocheted gloves for people. She did a lot of things, not to be dependent solely on welfare. She didn't like them telling her what she could do and what she couldn't do.
And this is one of the main things that devastated her more than anything else. As time went by, you could see she was wearing down.
For 7 years, as Malcolm grew into adolescence, his mother slowly withdrew from her family. 2 days before Christmas, 1938, Louise Little was diagnosed as paranoid and was sent to Kalamazoo State Hospital.
When I came home from school one day, and she wasn't there. I can remember being empty because my mother had never left us. And I felt, you know, the pain of her being gone every day. And it was only going to be a couple weeks. You know, she was going to get better and come right back home. And it turned into years.
Louise Little would remain at Kalamazoo for the next 26 years. The 13-year-old Malcolm watched as the courts split up his family, assigning the younger children to foster homes in Lansing and sending him to a white community 10 miles away.
In the past, the greatest weapon the white man has had has been his ability to divide and conquer. If I take my hand and slap you, you don't even feel it. It might sting you because these digits are separated. But all I have to do to put you back in your place is bring those digits together.
Here was a man who, in the eighth grade in Michigan, a school where I think he was the only black in his class and one of the very few in the school, had been an outstanding A, straight A student, you know, who had been, in fact, the president of his class. And all the others were white in the eighth grade. Obviously, he had to be exceptional to be those things. And then you had the Malcolm who had left school and who had gone to Roxbury, Massachusetts, where he had gotten his first exposure to what might loosely be called hustling.
Myself a little hustler up in Roxbury in those days. And this particular day, you know, Malcolm X had come into Boston and he had on his zoot suit with the wide brim hat, with the long 3/4 length coat, with the chain that went down to your ankles. I don't know, the last time I recall, Cab Calloway used that outfit for his stage uniform.
Now, when Malcolm left Lansing, he had nothing but an old square suit on, white man suit, as I call it. When he came back from Boston, oh, Lord, Malcolm had his loot suit on and a wide brim hat, a chain from his hat down into his lapel, and he was the talk of the town. Everybody was talking about Malcolm.
And then when he was dancing on the floor and he was floating around, those pants were like he was a floating balloon. And that coat was like a wing, the way he'd be dancing and flying around with that big 10-gallon hat on and the chain flinging. And this used to really shake up the girls.
When you do, you'll not get to into killer dilla dilla spot. It's a new moose spot. It's the best brew spot.
In Boston, they call him New York Red. In New York, they call him Detroit Red. He had his hair crocodiled, conked, you know. It was red, and he had pictures of him and Billie Holiday and all these people at that time out there who were just being made known to the rest of the black world.
Malcolm worked the kitchen crew on the New Haven Railroad between Boston, New York, and Washington, D.C. In 1942, he moved to Harlem, and at age 17, began traveling in a whirl of after-hour clubs and small-time hustlers.
He had reached a point to where he said, you'll never make it on these janitor jobs and selling sandwiches on these trains and shining shoes and stuff like that. So you never will get anywhere.
Well, he had the reputation as being a hustler. And he was a street person, but he was a hustler. He was a con man. Yeah, con artist. They call him an artist.
When the white folks came out at night, and they wanted black women, he could arrange for them to get them. If they wanted bootleg whiskey, he knew where to get it. If they wanted drugs, he knew where to get it. He made it possible that he knew what they wanted, and he knew how to where to get it, and he would be in the middle where he could make a profit off of it. And this is the way he started doing.
Looking back at that time, Malcolm said only three things worried him: jail, a job, and the army. To avoid serving in World War II, he told his draft board that he wanted to organize black soldiers to kill whites. He was judged unfit for the military. Malcolm's gambling and drugs and Harlem nightlife were expensive. He had already been arrested twice for petty crimes. When he moved back to Boston in 1945, he organized a gang to burglarize homes of prominent families. The other gang members included his friend, Malcolm Jarvis, his white girlfriend, Bee, and two other white women.
This girl knew that these people were down in Florida at that time of the year. There was nobody home, so we broke into the house and we'd get some of their valuables, and Malcolm would take most of the stuff and pawn it and get money for his gambling habit. After 2 weeks of doing this, that's when the case broke, when he made the mistake of going to the pawn shop to retrieve a watch with over $1,000 that came out of one of the houses. And that's when he was arrested by three policemen.
Malcolm Little, Malcolm Jarvis, and the three women were charged with breaking and entering. The fact that two black men were with white women became an issue in the court.
Malcolm was definitely involved with two white women, and this is what made the case so powerful, so outrageous.
The women testified that Malcolm had forced them to participate in the burglaries. The two men received a maximum sentence, 8 to 10 years in state prison.
When they sentenced us, I went out of my mind. I reached up and grabbed the bars of the cage and I shook them, almost shook them right up off the floor. And I hollered at the judge and I said to him, you might as well kill me as to give me 10 years in jail.
Well, I was what they call a mad Negro. I was one. And I knew what I saw was real. I know there wasn't anything funny about it. I knew that when they laughed all together, they were laughing, then look what we did. We're doing it to the Negro.
Then they had the unintimidated gall to ask the girls before they took them out of there to press charges against us for rape. The girls wouldn't do it.
Malcolm Little was 20 years old, facing 8 to 10 years in state prison. He had wandered far from the Garvey pride and independence his parents had preached. He was now prisoner number 22843.
To have once been a criminal is no disgrace. To remain a criminal is the disgrace. I formerly was a criminal. I formerly was in prison. I'm not ashamed of that. You never can use that over my head. And that he's using the wrong stick. I don't feel that stick. Charged Jesus with sedition. Didn't they do that? They said he was against Caesar. They said he was discriminating because he told his disciples, go not the way of the Gentiles, but rather go to the lost sheep. Go to the people who don't know who they are, who are lost from the knowledge of themselves, and who are strangers in a land that is not theirs. Go to those people. Go to the slaves. Go to the second-class citizens. Go to the ones who are suffering the brunt of Caesar's brutality. And if Jesus were here in America today, he wouldn't be going to the white man. The white man is the oppressor. He would be going to the oppressed. He would be going to the humble. He would be going to the lowly. He would be going to the rejected and the despised. He would be going to the so-called American Negro.
Behind prison walls, Malcolm hustled bets, fed his drug habit, and argued against the existence of God. The men in the cell block called him Satan. But at the same time, encouraged by an older black inmate, Malcolm began reading and taking English courses.
Malcolm described vividly prison life, that he was in effect lonely and limited, but had plans for, he was going to do a lot of reading. And he certainly did a lot of writing, because I think there were times when he probably wrote to me every week.
During the second year in prison, his brothers and sisters wrote to him about what they called the natural religion for the black man. A religion that taught that black people were the original people, that God was black and was called Allah. They told Malcolm they were now a part of the Nation of Islam, followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the messenger of Allah.
I think Islam is one of the greatest religions of all time for our people in America. The so-called American Negro have to be completely re-educated. And Islam gives him that qualification that he can feel proud and does not feel ashamed to be called a black man.
I came into the Muslim movement in 1947 and then started bringing my brothers and sisters in. And we already had been indoctrinated with the Marcus Garvey's philosophy. So they didn't have anything to do with convincing us about we were black and should be proud. We were already there when we came in.
So I wrote to Malcolm and told him about, I said to him, if he would believe in Allah, that he would get out of prison. And that's all I wrote, because I know he had very low tolerance for religion, and I didn't intend to lose that tolerance.
Malcolm's brothers and sisters wrote the young prisoner that black people in America were part of a lost tribe soon to be delivered out of bondage, and that whites, according to Elijah Muhammad, were a race of devils whose domination on earth was about to end.
At first, he liked every bit of it, except one thing he couldn't understand, and that was the part they were teaching about the white man being the devil.
Malcolm wrote to Elijah Muhammad. Elijah Muhammad answered. And when he answered, he would cite a portion of scripture. And then he gave him the key. He said, the key, the Bible is the book, that everything that takes place in that Bible is on this earth.
So you don't have to die to go to hell. You can catch hell while you're living. And the white man is the one that's putting that hell on you. Well, that's a very convincing teaching, especially when you're using the white man's history to corroborate this.
Malcolm began reading history, philosophy, and religion. The writings of W.E.B. Du Bois, Shakespeare, Socrates, the fables of Aesop, the lives of Gandhi and Nat Turner.
And he finds all this history of how white Christians lynched black Christians. White Christians were the ones who were involved in the slave trade. Those were Christians. So Malcolm began to see this, and then he began to study it himself and prove if there is such a thing as a real devil on this earth, it has to be the white man.
Elijah Muhammad told Malcolm to submit to Allah. But for Malcolm, submission would always be difficult. It took a week before he could force himself to bow in prayer. Later, to help spread the teachings of Elijah Muhammad, Malcolm joined the prison debate team, competing against visiting college teams from Harvard and MIT.
That's when Malcolm's name and fame started spreading amongst the prison population. And that's when the population started to grow at the debating classes. Most of the fellas used to come over out of curiosity just to hear him speak.
In 1950, Malcolm wrote to the governor demanding the right to practice the Muslim religion in prison. His letters would later end up in FBI files. The Bureau had been keeping a close watch on the Nation of Islam since the late 1930s. Malcolm, considered a troublemaker, was denied an early parole.
He was not eligible to be let out at that time because he'd be a threat to society. They considered him dangerous, knowledge-wise and otherwise, and religious-wise. He would have been like a rotten apple in the barrel of a thousand. He was going to spoil many.
On August 7th, 1952, after 6.5 years in prison, Malcolm was released. Within a month, he was accepted into the Nation of Islam. Malcolm Little had become Malcolm X.
How did you happen to join the Muslim movement?
I was in prison. I was a very wayward, criminal, backward, illiterate, uneducated, and whatever other negative characteristics you can think of, type of person, until I heard the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And because of the impact that it had upon me in giving me a desire to reform myself and rehabilitate myself for the first time in my life, and also being able to see the effect that it had upon others, this is what made me accept it. And I noticed that after being exposed to the religious teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, immediately it instilled within me such a high degree of racial pride and racial dignity that I wanted to be somebody. And I realized that I couldn't be anybody by begging the white man for what he had, but that I had to get out here and try and do something for myself or make something out of myself.
The first time I recall seeing Malcolm was at the home of my father, Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And I saw a thin man, tall man, young man, reddish face. If he was just meeting you, the first thing you would get from him is a smile. He said, "This is Wallace." And I smiled with him. I was happy to see him because I had heard about him too. And he said, "The messenger's son, the messenger's son." And he was just so excited about the messenger. Really, it wasn't just seeing Wallace, it was seeing the messenger's son.
When Malcolm came out, he was full of fire. He had gotten so full of fire that he got out at the right time in the right place so he could expound. He came to Detroit. He was surprised to find there were such few people in this powerful teaching in his mind. And he says, "I'm surprised that you are sitting here in so many empty seats." He said, "Every time you come out here," he said, "this place should be full." And that excited the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
In the early 1950s, the Nation of Islam was unknown in most black communities. Total membership was believed to be no more than 400 people. Malcolm was sent on the road to spread the message. Within 2 years, he helped organize temples in Boston, Hartford, and Philadelphia. Elijah Muhammad then named Malcolm minister of the most important temple on the East Coast, Harlem's Temple No. 7.
Mr. Muhammad knew that Malcolm had the experience, that he knew New York, and he also knew that he was the kind of man, complexion, height, speech, and carriage, All that has to be taken in consideration when you select a man to stand before the people. Plus, this is an international city. You got to have your best in New York. And this is why Mr. Muhammad selected him.
In 1955, when Elijah Muhammad visited the New York Temple, it was to inspect the work of the ambitious and outspoken young minister who had transformed tiny storefronts along the East Coast into a congregation of thousands.
Malcolm X and Elijah Muhammad's message made a whole lot of people feel whole again, human being again. Some of them came out and found a new meaning to their manhood and their womanhood. Had Elijah Muhammad tried to introduce an orthodox form of Arab-oriented Islam, I doubt if he would have attracted 500 people. But he introduced a form of Islam that could communicate with the people he had to deal with. He was the king to those who had no king. He was the Messiah to those some people thought unworthy of a Messiah.
The teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is like nothing I have ever taken. It's a medicine.
Right.
You see,
right.
It's the medicine that has cured me of all my ills.
Yes,
because I was a sick man.
That's right.
And when I embraced the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, these teachings cured me of these ills.
Right.
I'm a well man now.
Right.
And I feel good.
That's right. As long as you stay with the doctor, you continue.
Yes, sir. Yes, right. Sir.
What about you, brother? How do you feel about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad?
Honorable Elijah Muhammad is trying to teach all our original people they are in bad shape.
Yeah. Go ahead, brother.
Honorable Elijah Muhammad trying to wake them up.
Inside Muslim temples, no white people were allowed. Members worked to build a self-sufficient community, founded on strict rules and absolute obedience. The nation set up Muslim schools for its children, teaching mathematics, science, history, and Arabic.
Who is the original man? The original man is the Asiatic black man, the maker of the arms of the queen of the planet Earth.
Muslim women studied nutrition, child rearing, and guidelines on how to care for their husbands. Muslim men studied parental responsibility, history, and religion. The elite corps, called the Fruit of Islam, was trained in hand-to-hand combat and was expected to protect the temples and to punish any members who spoke out against the messenger.
I was surprised when I went into a couple of the Muslim families, the faith that they had in Elijah Muhammad and in Malcolm. I asked one father, I said, suppose your son came home one day and told you that he was renouncing the Muslim religion. He said, I would turn him from my door and would never allow him in again. So I asked Malcolm about that. He said, he meant it, and he would do that. I said, not worry about what happened to his son? No, he wouldn't worry about what happened to him. His allegiance is with Elijah Muhammad.
To help expand the Nation of Islam, Malcolm created a newspaper, Muhammad Speaks, and persuaded other black newspapers to carry the Messenger's weekly column.
His strength was, once he believed in a thing, he would give everything he had to it, all of his energies. He'd work, he'd become a workaholic. He worked day and night for it.
He only required around 4 hours sleep, and many times wouldn't get that. And you just kind of wonder, how can anybody keep up that kind of a pace? But he did it, day in and day out. Plus, on top of that, he's reading. He's reading papers, keeping up what the news is. He's just a person that's tuned into life in such a way that he doesn't miss too much of it.
At age 32, after devoting 5 years to building the nation, he sought the approval of Elijah Muhammad to marry Sister Betty X, a college-educated member of Harlem's Temple No. 7. In the years that followed, the demands of his ministry allowed little time for his growing family.
He sometime, if I could catch him, would have to read to the children. They would always want the story read again so that they would really just wait until he was on the last page and said, read it again, read it again, read it again. You know, and so that he started giving the books different endings.
He had a beautiful sense of humor, especially when he was kidding me about pork and whacking me on the back and saying that you're a decent human being, smart historian. I'm going to give you 99 as a human being, and you stop eating pork, I'm going to give you 100. Had a beautiful sense of humor, plus the fact that when you got to know him, he was kind of shy.
Malcolm was now in the Nation of Islam's inner circle, Elijah Muhammad's most visible representative. He had the messenger's confidence and the loyalty of thousands of Muslims. In a sense, Malcolm had found a father. Elijah Muhammad had found another son. On an April night in 1957, a Muslim brother was beaten by New York City police. His skull fractured, Johnson Hinton lay in a back room of a Harlem police station. When word spread that Hinton was dying, Malcolm ordered the Muslims into the streets. Other Harlem residents joined them. The community had endured a long history of police brutality. Many considered the police an occupying force.
28th Precinct was notorious for the prejudice. Naturally, when the people saw us come out there, that was the first time that anyone had marched on the 28th Precinct in protest of something that they felt that wasn't right.
I don't know what would have happened in Harlem that night, because the atmosphere was not, as I think the word they use is charged. Well, this atmosphere was explosive.
Malcolm demanded medical treatment for Hinton. After a long negotiation, police agreed to send the prisoner to Harlem Hospital. But even then, the Muslims refused to disperse.
This sergeant, he came out and tried to chase the Muslims who were standing across the street. And Malcolm came out and told him, you can't do that. He said, they're not going to move for you. Malcolm said, I'll send them away. He went out to the front of the station on the first step and just waved his hand, and the people walked away.
A police commissioner on the scene remarked, that's too much power for one man to have. Malcolm would later take New York City to court and win the largest police brutality settlement in the city's history.
And they realized that anytime a person could wave his hand and have a large number of people automatically move away without any conversation, that by the same token, that same man could wave his hand and cause those people to create some kind of disturbance if he wanted to. I believe from that point on, the police department and the political people in New York City began to realize they had a significant force in the city to deal with.
All right. Peace, peace, peace. You know what? I think that's a perfect, this is a perfect stopping point, because for next week on part two, being here at the Hate to Hate Produce, this is going to represent a shift in energies. This is going to represent a new variable coming into the equation that I don't want to start tonight if we're not going to finish it tonight. You know what I'm saying? If we're not going to finish it tonight. So we're going to stop right here while after the documentary just demonstrated Malcolm kind of at the height of his influence and power inside of the nation of Islam. And so I'm going to stop it right here. And the link is in the chat. The link is in the chat. You know what I'm saying? Anybody that would like to join in. Anybody that would like to join in and discuss what we've watched. I've seen some of you were very engaged. I saw some chats. I know I was chatting it up, but that's what I do. That kept me from pausing the movie. You know what I'm saying? That kept me from pausing the movie, being able to chat, being in the chat, right? But I know Cheryl Irvin, and shout out to the new Akibalon STEM Academy in Florida. Yes, black folks out here building schools, y'all. You know what I'm saying? But Cheryl remarked, you know what I'm saying, that she's learned a lot of things about Malcolm that she didn't know before, and how it's amazing to hear it directly from his siblings. Yeah, this documentary came out in the 90s. It's been out for a while, but I by no means make assumptions that everybody's seen it. Right. And sometimes we'll see something and engage in something like, yeah, I've seen that a million times. And I have seen this this documentary several times. You know what I'm saying? But I wanted to share it today. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm not sure who have studied the life of Malcolm X in depth. You know what I'm saying? And society has a way to reduce people to slogans and reduce people to just a one compartment of their life and then kind of throw the rest in the trash. But you can't really understand a person if you don't understand where they come from. If you don't understand, and I'm looking at the wrong camera, that's why I'm looking up like this, but we'll get it together. But if you don't understand their origin story, right? And so, yeah, man, excellent documentary, you know what I'm saying? And source of insight into the life of Elhaj Malik El-Shabazz or Malcolm X, you know, most commonly known as Malcolm X. You know what I'm saying? So the link is in the chat. If anybody would like to jump into the stream yard, the link is in the chat. I'm going to give it a couple of seconds, but, you know, or even in comments, if you have any questions, if you have, let me know what stood out for you. Just learning about Malcolm's early life. I took a few notes that I like to do, just kind of remember some topics that I wanted to bring up in this brief discussion. The documentary opened up. The narrator for this documentary, by the way, is an actor, and he was an activist in his own right. Ozzie Davis. Right. If you don't know who Ozzie Davis is, right. If you don't know who Ozzie Davis is, you definitely want to look him up and check him out. You know what I'm saying? And matter of fact, him and his wife, Ruby Dee, they were like, you know what I'm saying, that intellectual power, black power couple in the 50s, 60s. But yeah, check out Ozzie Davis. He did a great job. I put the link in the chat. I don't know if you can see it, Cheryl, with the stream that you're on. So let me see here. Let me do it. Let me post it in here again. All right. I don't know if it's coming to you. It's going to one of it. Go check. Go to the stream that's running on my personal Facebook page. Okay. Yeah. Or go to the YouTube. Go to the YouTube and you should be able to see the comment. Go to the Uhura Academy YouTube channel. And if you haven't subscribed to the Uhura Academy YouTube channel, you need to do that. All right. You need to do that. Go ahead and subscribe. More content is coming, but go ahead and subscribe. All right. Go ahead and subscribe to the Uhura Academy YouTube channel. You should be able to put in the Uhuru Academy, U-H-U-R-U Academy, and pull that up. All right. So go ahead and check that out and jump on in. All right. So dealing with Malcolm's early life, right? It's so many lessons that we can pull from each other's lives. You know what I'm saying? And whew, every generation or so, you have people who live extraordinary lives that we could really, really pull lessons from. And peace, Miss Wright, peace. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? And so Malcolm had one of those lives. Malcolm had one of those lives that you know, it's a trip, because when I learned about Malcolm, I was my freshman year in high school. I'm not high school, my freshman year in college, Wiley College. I took a Black Studies class. My teacher, Dr. A.J. Stovall, assigned the autobiography of Malcolm X. Y'all, I graduated near the top of my class in high school. I went to all Black high school. I had no idea who Malcolm X was when I got to college. This was 1990, 1991 school year was my first year in college. I had no idea who Malcolm X was, right? So I get assigned this book, The Autobiography of Malcolm X, and I'm like, whoa, right? And it's a trip, because not only did I not know who he was, but it forever influenced my perspective on Malcolm, which is cool, because like I never saw Malcolm as a slogan, because I'd never heard any other slogans, right? I think the movie actually came out like a year or so after I was introduced to Malcolm X, or to the teachings of Malcolm X, right? So my view wasn't already skewed. I didn't know who this man was. I didn't know about violence, nonviolence, anything like that, right? So I know Malcolm through his life story. That's how I was introduced to him, through his life story. So then when I learned his politics, I had all kinds of context already there. There was no moment for me to say, man, why he felt like that? Man, why was he so? He looked mad. He looked angry. So there was no room for me to look at that and have any of my Eurocentric thoughts to kick in. Like, oh, that's just an angry Black man. Oh, that's just old militant. None of that. I was introduced to him through his life. And that's the best way, you know, to introduce our ancestors, even in your bloodline. You know what I'm saying? Introducing, just like you introduce people in your family and that sort of thing, right? Your grandparents, great grandparents, learn their story. You'll learn more about you if you learn their story. So I was introduced to Malcolm through his life, right? And so that gives those of us who were introduced to him through his life, we had the benefit of having a view of Malcolm that wasn't skewed. So no one ever came to me and said, don't say that, Malcolm. We down with Martin over here. Don't say that, Malcolm. Nobody came to me and said, no, don't look at that. That's militant stuff, right? Right. And so, you know, it's huge. It's huge because learning his story gives us a view and a perspective of our history that we don't often get. And I love this documentary because you have people telling it that were there. Right? You have people telling it that were actually there. And that makes a difference. His siblings, they were actually there. Right? Right? And it was such an opening up the open up documentary. Ozzie Davis mentioned, he talked about our mental desire to be accepted by white people. Right? Right. How, you know, and talked about Malcolm from the perspective of fighting Black inferiority. Right. And that's one thing that stands out for me with the approach of organizations like Marcus Garvey's UNIA or Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad's Nation of Islam. Right. Or Minister Farrakhan's Nation of Islam. Right. And other programs that come and ask us to deal with us first. Right. Hold on before we go fight for freedom. Stop drinking. Hold on before we stop. Go fight for freedom. Stop cussing. Be dedicated to your family. Clean yourself up. Adopt a restrictive, healthy diet. You know what I'm saying? Like making that your foundation. Or even here's this religion I got for you. Or this belief system I got for you. And there are rules in this belief system, right? These are systems designed to fight Black inferiority. Right. Just in the sense that they call on us to change personally, internally, to our core. They challenge our core values. Like you could join the Black Panther Party, irregardless of your core values, or your religion, because it's more of a secular organization, and Black Panthers ain't gonna tell you how to live. You can join Black Lives Matter, you can join CORE, you can join SNCC, you can join these organizations, right? But these organizations are fighting external forces. But we also had organizations inside our community that focused on internal forces, and those organizations were often spiritual organizations, right? And so I like that Ozzy broke that down and talked a little bit about that in the beginning. And then some of the people we saw Dr. John Henry Clark there. Man, one of the greatest historians of all time, right? Someone that we have so much gratitude for, you know, for all his work. A lot of the stuff y'all hear folks say that y'all say is woke and know our history and that sort of thing. These are some of the people that we learn from, whose work that we study, you know, whose work that we've learned from. Look up John Henry Clark. All right. He actually has a documentary that we're going to watch one day called A Great and Mighty Walk about his life. But you saw John Henry Clark in the documentary bringing perspective, the perspective of like a colleague. He wasn't a member of the Nation of Islam, but he was an organizer inside in Harlem, an educator and an organizer, you know what I'm saying, in his own right. You know, and him and Malcolm had a friendship and had a bond, you know, so definitely check out John Henry Clark as well. You know, great to see him. You saw Sonia Sanchez, a great poet. Definitely want to check out Sonia Sanchez. She brings a fresh perspective. She was a young girl and saw Malcolm, you know what I'm saying, on the corners speaking and lecturing, you know, and she even described the time she came up to him and met him and everything and how he responded, basically talking about his presence, the presence that he had. Right. And just that presence that was captivating, you know. Malcolm had that gift. He had the gift to be able to get on stage and figure out the right things to say, how to connect with the crowd, you know. And that's a gift that not everyone has. Right. Now, it's a gift that you have to be careful with. You know what I'm saying? You have to be careful with, because none of us are out there alone. And sometimes when you're the one with the gift of gab, people may think it's you, and they don't see your team, right? That's why inside the Nation of Islam, followers always made sure they say the most honored Elijah Muhammad teaches us. Or when you clap for them, they say all praise is due to Allah, to take the praise off of them, because they know they deliver something powerful, right? But you got to watch out, because your ego will take over and you'll start thinking it's you and start making all kind of crazy decisions. You know what I'm saying? And so there's a science to this. There's a science to leadership. There's a science to organizing, community organizing. You know what I'm saying? And there are disciplines that are necessary, you know, in order to make things work, right? And just when you think about an organization like the Nation of Islam at that time, you're talking about a 100% Black-owned enterprise, right, that was building businesses all over the country, that established its own economy. They were circulating their funds with one another, building schools, right? And I'm talking about in the 30s, into the 40s, into the 60s, until the first fall in 1975. But 1931 to 1975 is a pretty good run. It's a pretty good run. It's enough of a sample size for us to analyze it, right? And to look at it and see, what did they do? What were the key aspects of that? Because we talk about sometimes building a Black America inside of America. We talk about owning our culture. We talk about circulating our dollars and keeping it in our communities, you know what I'm saying, for as long as we can before it leaves our community. What does that look like? And the Nation of Islam gives us a sample size, that early Nation of Islam, especially because they were opening clinics, schools, they were farming, they were in the transportation business. So they were moving goods from place to place. They were circulating the dollars. They had media with the Muhammad Speaks newspaper. They had a headquarter, they had a mosque system, a ministry system. They had a security force. for men and women, right? So we need to look at, you know, some of those key elements. What, you know what I'm saying? Because you could fortify your community like that. We worry about losing our children and what they thinking about, where they going. We social media kicking our butt right now. As far as influence on children, influence on is kicking our butt right now. Right? We need some formulas. I'm talking math, y'all. We need some formulas on how to counter out that. So I want you to notice the elements of the teachings of the Nation of Islam that were counteracting many of the obstacles that kept Black people from taking full advantage of any opportunities that may be out there, right? Because our history is full of scenarios where there's a right out there that we actually have, but we either don't have the discipline or the education to take advantage of that right, or take advantage or exercise that power. So I can give you all the rights in the world, but if I keep you drunk, if I keep you high, if I keep you poor, right, then I keep your power. You can have the rights. I just want to keep the power. Y'all see the dynamic? All right. So great. A lot of great things I saw in the film. And let me see here. Powerful statement. Michael Whitley, shout out to you. Say he forgot the awe factor Malcolm initially enthused when he first joined the Nation. Yeah. You know, when he came out right now. And one of the things I learned in the documentary was Malcolm made his name while he was in prison. He made a transformation while he was in prison. And, you know, that kind of movie kind of portrays that he converted in prison. Then he did some debates, read the dictionary. Then he came out like kind of like a fresh rookie into the Nation. Right. But did y'all notice that Malcolm was already demanding, he was fighting for Muslim rights, you know what I'm saying, in while he was in prison. So he got active immediately, right? And so by the time he came out of prison, you know what I'm saying, he was expected. He was expected to lead, right? Matter of fact, a lot of his development happened, his training happened in prison. When he came out ready to work, right? And that speaks to the fact that in shout out to all political prisoners and Black people who are unjustly held behind the wall. Shout out to those who I know personally that were teachers in there, that were helping young men transform themselves while they were behind the wall, and sent back to us leaders in our community, sent good fathers back to us, sent good husbands back to us, right? We assume, yeah, that jail kicked your butt. That's why you don't do crime no more. No. A lot of times they come back, those who don't go back, they don't go back because of a transformative program they embrace while in there. And the strongest programs aren't financed by the state or the Fed. The strongest programs are organized and held down by the brothers and the sisters over on the other side. The strong programs are in there. So if you have a teacher connected to you in there, if you have someone who's working in there behind the walls to transform that baby that might be coming home in 6 years, the one that might be coming home in 3 years, 5 years, shout out to all those behind the wall who's turning prison into college and helping to send us back men who got their mind right and who are focused on getting out here and being an asset to the community. All right. So, yeah, Malcolm's transformation was a major, major thing. Because a part of the prison, the capitalist prison agenda, is to make sure you have prisoners. And you can't have prisoners if people are going to prison, learning how not to go back to prison. Okay, you can't sustain the business model like that. You can't sustain the business model if you don't have prisoners. You can't sustain the business model. Right. So shout out to those behind the walls who are dedicated to helping the youngsters who come through, dedicated to helping others who come through to find themselves spiritually, to find themselves culturally, to find their purpose in life, and sending them home on fire. It's our job to build institutions out here that are ready to receive them when they come home, the way the nation was ready to receive Malcolm. Y'all see how that works? And it wasn't a re-entry grant from the government. It was black folks, black folksing. It was us building a program from ground up, ways of lives from ground up for ourselves. Right? And so, and that benefited everybody. I know people are like, well, yeah, but they said the white man was the devil. Man, look, let me tell you something. Right, when the nation grew as a business, and they were doing business and circulating dollars and taking brothers off the streets, right, taking sisters off the streets, they cleaning up. These are becoming homeowners and taxpayers, huh? He's actually turning you into something that you ain't gonna feed the economy on an exploitative level, but it feeds the economy when we're circulating our dollars in our community because they tax everything that we make. Right? So they wasn't hurting nobody. They wasn't attacking white people. They wasn't robbing white people. They wasn't hurting nobody, but they were getting strong, building a strong base inside our community. We need to look at that formula. We need to look at that formula. I'm not saying do exactly that, but we need to look at that formula and not turn our nose up at the necessity of discipline if we're going to make an impact today. Right? And so, yeah, very interesting just watching that dynamic, man, just watching this young man in prison, you know, who they nicknamed Satan in prison, and to watch how his family, a lot of us let our people go, his family, who were way back in Lansing, Michigan, they in the Midwest, he's gone from them. He's Harlem. He's New York Malcolm now. Right? He's not standing on the principles that their parents laid down. He's not doing that. Right? Now, of course, he was so young when his father was killed, he mostly saw the suffering side. I think he was only four when his father, maybe between four and seven when his father was killed. So he didn't get a lot of the lessons from his father. He didn't get, and he was the youngest of eight siblings. So he got the least amount of time seeing the image of Earl and Louise Little. So it makes sense that his siblings would still be holding on to those principles or would grow up and find a path that was similar to the path that their parents were on. Because remember, their parents were Garveyites. Okay, and they were inside their home, they were passing down the principles of self-reliance, of independence, of cultural pride. But Malcolm didn't get a lot of that in person. He got his mom, Louise Little, trying to hold the family together. And also being terrorized by the state, because the state sanctioned the murder of his father, then sanctioned the terrorizing and ultimate committing of Malcolm's mother. It's the state of Michigan. Yeah. So Malcolm got that. Malcolm got the part where he saw his mother committed to a mental institution for the rest of her life. This is a brilliant and dynamic woman, Louise Little. Matter of fact, her family, I believe they sanctioned and got together. And there's a book about her. And I put it in the chat and I'm going to show it right quick. There's a book, a biography on Louise Little that y'all need to check out, that you need to put in your library. Okay, and I'm gonna put the title up in the chat here in just a second. Ooh, okay, I've been chatting a lot. there it is, right? The Life of Louise Norton Little, an extraordinary woman, mother of Malcolm X and his seven siblings, right? Check that out. I've actually been reading it this month, and just check out where he came from. I mean, if you want to understand Malcolm, we have the benefit of being able to study his parents. You want to understand the tree, study the roots, right? And so so Malcolm got that side when the state was attacking his mother, then split him up from his family, right? And then he ends up in New York. You know what I'm saying? So he ain't walking around with black pride in New York. Now, you know, for him, black pride meant daddy killed, mama yanked out of the home, family split up. So he wasn't on that, right? And it's a trip how when he got a hold with his siblings, older siblings, who got some of that, was able to maintain that, found the Nation of Islam, and then reached out to Malcolm while he was in prison. They didn't forget him. Their youngest sibling who had been taken away, who moved to New York City. And so they reached back out and got Malcolm. And I found that to be a very compelling part of the story. A very compelling part of the story. You could write, you can do short films on the Little family, on the Littles. Malcolm comes from some fascinating people. From among some fascinating people. He was born into a fascinating family. A fascinating family that was really seeking out what they call it the American dream. They were really seeking out their American dream, right? In a non-compliant, non-reliant, let me say non-reliant, non-dependent kind of way. And it was the jealousy of the white community where they were in the north in Lansing, Michigan, coupled with not just the jealousy, but coupled with their political involvement with the UNIA, right? And remember, the UNIA was also under FBI surveillance. Matter of fact, it was one of J. Edgar Hoover's first case was infiltrating the UNIA. It's highly possible that the feds instigated the terrorism against the Littles. It would make sense. It would make sense that they may have been watching the Littles. That maybe even helped instigate, you know, the destruction of that family. Y'all think reparations is just about slavery. Yeah. So the Littles, man, the family reached out. I always wonder why Spike didn't put that in the movie, why Spike Lee didn't show that the family were the ones that reached out to Malcolm in prison and not a fellow prisoner. Right. And so I wonder that. I wonder that. And I believe in Alex Haley's book. I'm trying to remember if in the autobiography of Malcolm X, if Malcolm X says that it was his family that reached out to him, or if it was a fellow prisoner that reached out to him. I'd be interested to know. I know that Alex Haley took some license with the autobiography because Malcolm transitioned before it was done. That's why when you see the book autobiography of Malcolm X, it'll say as told to Alex Haley, because Malcolm didn't physically write the book. Alex Haley physically wrote the book, but he was recording. He had recorded interviews, and so he was working on the book with Malcolm. Right. So check multiple resources. Good to hear directly from his siblings. It's good to hear directly from them. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, it helps us not over romanticize the past too. You know what I'm saying? Like when Malcolm got to Harlem, you know, I mean, he was out there, right? He was out there in them streets. You know, a lot of folks think because it was the 1940s that it wasn't no streets, that it wasn't no hood. Oh, it was hood. Oh yeah. It was. oh, absolutely. Black folks with black folks, and y'all saw them with the zoot suits on and dancing, and you know what I'm saying? So we've always been the wave. Like culture is our superpower. You know what I'm saying? And culture is our immune system, but our culture is our superpower. You know what I'm saying? We've been the flyers. Just as soon as they let we free, we off the plantation. Pow, watch this. I can express myself musically. Pow, watch this. Right? They used to find black people on plantations singing, dancing, creating music, creating instruments. Right? And so that power was there. So you saw images of black folks dancing, doing the Lindy Hop and all that, you know, and that was that whole Renaissance time. We're really coming off the Renaissance. You're really coming through the Depression. Right. But you can see that Harlem was still hopping at that time. And Malcolm was hitting the streets. And we were doing what we do. Right. Right. And of course, suffering from a lot of miseducation. You know, and that stuff at the same time, right? So it was really, really good to see the backdrop and understand the setting, right? Again, to not reduce Malcolm X to a slogan. This is a life that's worthy of being studied. I don't know if y'all seen the Dear Mama documentary about Tupac, right? The parallels between Malcolm and Pac, right, are amazing, right? You know, you have both who come from revolutionary parents. Malcolm's parents were UNIA. Pac's mother was a black in the Black Panther Party. Different generation, right? You got the 30s, you got the 20s and 30s. Malcolm parents and their youth, they're getting involved in the Garvey movement, which was a Back to Africa movement, which is a black sovereignty movement, right? The red, black, and green, the RBG. So Malcolm's parents and their youth, and in their youth, they're in the teens, the 19-teens and 1920s. Put this in perspective. Birth of a Nation is in theaters. Okay, the president of the United States is showing screenings of this new movie, silent movie called Birth of a Nation, which is about the rise of the heroic Ku Klux Klan at the White House. With just what, 60, about 60 years up from slavery. And this is an amazing time. An amazing time. And in New York, you have a convergence of black people from the islands, the Caribbean and Haiti and other places coming in. And then you got an influx of black people from the South, especially around the early 1900s, during the Great Migration, heading into that area. So now you got this convergence of black cultures in Harlem, in New York, at this epicenter. It becomes an epicenter of black thought. You get Arturo Schomburg opening up the Schomburg Library, which was a library of African history and art. A museum of African history and art right there in New York during this time. You see Malcolm, when he didn't have a corner for himself, he was working with the bookstore, the brother at the bookstore. You'll never get integration. Y'all remember him? Right? It was already a conscious community. It was a vibe already there. Because you got this convergence of black thought in this area because of where New York is situated. Right? And so that backdrop, that time in our history, we have to study that time. We need to study the attitudes, not just the names and the dates. We need to study the attitudes. We need to study the mentalities. When Malcolm met Betty, Betty was a college graduate. Right? You had black people getting their education, believing that education and land were the keys to freedom. They was on to something. And they own, black people collectively own more land in this country than we do now. Black people collectively have more businesses in this country than we do now. What was the mentality? Also during that time, black couples were the most married. Yeah. And stayed married. What was the mentality? What was the purpose? What was the thought process behind that? And was it effective? You see what happened to Malcolm's family once they removed the father from the home. Mama tried to maintain, but what did Malcolm's brother say? She couldn't run faster than me. She couldn't run faster than Malcolm. Off my sister Cheryl. Right? So we need to study these dynamics. You can take Malcolm's life and build life skills curriculum right out of his life. Right? Because we're still dealing with a lot of those scenarios today. And we act like we don't have the answers. Right? What's up, Cheryl?
Hello. This is my first time on StreamYard, so I'm trying to figure out how to use it.
That's all right. You know, look around. You know, look around, check it out, take your time. You know, we just vibing, right? Okay. Right, we're just vibing on Malcolm. And was this your first time seeing this document, this particular documentary? Uh-oh, she must have found the leave studio button. She must have found the leave studio button, which is fine, which is fine. You know, I'm sure she'll jump back in when she can, right? Right. So, yeah, y'all. But the parallels between Malcolm and Pac. Revolutionary parents, you know, Pac's mom, the Black Panther Party, Malcolm's parents, UNIA, and I'm talking about these are what you call militant parents, okay? So you got that, and parents who are actively fighting the state, right? Right? You remember the part where they told Earl Little that the land that he had already purchased, already built the house on, already started a farm on, they decided to declare it whites only. That's the state coming after you. That's not a group of rednecks in the corner saying, no, that's whites only. No, they came with the paperwork. That's the state trying to evict them by declaring their land was whites only. Then you have Afeni Shakur being falsely accused of conspiracy and murder by the state of New York, and opting, seeing she was different, seeing the landscape and deciding to represent herself while pregnant, right? So both Pac and Malcolm were born to parents who were actively fighting the power, actively, in major ways, right? The parallels, okay? Then Pac was born under surveillance. Tupac was basically born under surveillance. Malcolm's family was most likely under surveillance, heavy surveillance. I mean, they, not just surveillance, I mean, they murdered the father, they murdered Earl Little, and then committed Louise Little. Because you know, just because they call you crazy don't mean you crazy, right? Right. And how, ain't it a trip that you murder my husband? You declared an accident. Everybody know it wasn't an accident. He didn't accidentally roll himself under a streetcar. So, and plus, we know you're lying, because when my house was firebombed, the city officially said that they started to arrest him for firebombing his own house. That was the city's response. When the Klan bombed the house, the city's response was, now we think you bombed it. Then he goes out one day and she had a premonition that something was going to happen. He goes out one day. She said, don't go, baby. If you go, you ain't coming back. The premonition comes true. Comes true. He doesn't come back. He's murdered. And now what do you do, city? You come back and you say, it was an accident. He accidentally rolled under the streetcar and ruled it that. How crazy is it that they come back after that? After she's trying to avoid being on welfare. And welfare back then ain't like what it is now, where you just get a card and they put money on it. They came to your house back then. The welfare experience back then, they sent workers out to your house that you had to line up all your children. Remember, she had 8. You got to line up all your children. They got to check them, and like on an auction block. They go look in your refrigerator, what you feeding the children, and that sort of thing. And then if you get a racist, there wasn't no black social workers. Now, you're already targeted. You've been targeted by the system. So how dare they say Louise Little was paranoid? They committed her saying she suffered from paranoia. The fear that something is about to happen to you. The fear of a conspiracy going on behind your back. The fear that someone's trying to kill you. Paranoia is when you have that fear, but the fear is legitimately not there. That's paranoia. Paranoia is when you perceive a threat that doesn't exist. That's paranoia. Louise Little wasn't paranoid. She was under attack. She was under attack. Everything she thought was happening was happening. The threat that she believed was there was real. Just want to make sure that people understand the difference. You know, this was a family that was being terrorized. And this is what Malcolm X was born into. You know, respect to Earl and Louise Little for attempting to be free. What's happening, Cheryl? I don't know what Cheryl got going on. I don't know what Cheryl got.
Every time I press the back button, it kicks me out. So I'm learning how to use these things.
Good. I know she said every time. You know, you're a scientist, so you experiment. You had to be sure that it was the back button, so you did it to yourself twice. You know what I'm saying? You had to test your theory. You was like, yeah, you are a scientist. You know, you was like, okay, wait a minute. I think I hit the back button, but let me go back in and hit the back button one more time just to make sure.
I'm not going to do it again. But I did want to say, every year here at New York, Kevin, we have a celebration for Malcolm X's birthday. We also have a week-long education where they watch documentaries. We haven't watched this one. This one I definitely have to put on the list of ones. On. They make artwork, all types of stuff so that they can get a connection to his life. But when you were just talking, one of the things I realized and one of the things I wanted to say to African-American educators or African educators out there, or even parents who are educating your children, and it just occurred to me, and I didn't do this last week, but we live in a 2023, the talk about mental health is one such that it really has to be explained. What you just said about his mother and paranoia, it really has to be explained to the children that she was not just experiencing mental health issues.
Right.
And I'm saying that because I didn't do that last week. And I know for a fact, based on my children's comments, that they left with a perception that she had to go to the hospital because she had mental health issues. And their education about mental health and the conversation around mental health right now is so steeped in a certain framework that they didn't get that this was not something that was happening inside of her, but something that was being imposed upon her from the outside.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting here as you're talking, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, that was a misstep on our part. But it's not something that can't be corrected. But I want to just caution educators and parents who are educating your children that it is actually important to point that out because of the framework around mental health that we live in 2023.
Right. You know, you can't find the solution to any health problem if you don't find its source in all sources, right? And so it's another story worth knowing. Louise Little raised the family, raised the family, right? It as a proud black woman, you know, and had to take on the state, had to take on the state to try to keep her children. And the state ultimately kidnapped her. But she was a fascinating woman just within her. When you study the context of the time that they were living in, the Ku Klux Klan was surrounding their house. Right. And to continue to defend their children, I mean, you know, you have to commend the strength and point out the strength, the mental toughness that it took to do that. Right. Yeah. And so, yeah, she was basically kidnapped and put into the system. I thought that was valuable. I thought it was valuable that there was contact between Malcolm and his family when he was in prison. You know, I like to point that out a lot, you know, especially because I deal, you know, over the years, I've dealt with a lot of young people who have incarcerated parents. And people are incarcerated people in their families. You know what I'm saying? And I think it's important to point out that that there's still connection there, you know, and that it can be positive, you know. And so Malcolm's transformation while incarcerated, you know what I'm saying, that we can't skim over that part of the story. Even I love they covered that and that they talked about how his family reached out to him and introduced him to the teachings of the Nation of Islam, you know, and it was within the context of, if you want to get out of prison, this is how you're going to get out.
Because if you only watch the Spike Lee movie, you get the impression that it was the nation from the inside, or that one particular man who he was connected to on the inside.
Right. In fact,
it was his siblings saying, we have already joined this movement, and it connects to what our father has been teaching us from day one. So he was already primed and ready to accept the teachings. It was some things about it that he had to you know, acclimate to, but it was introduced by his siblings, not this one man.
There's
reductionism that happens in Hollywood that we really have to monitor when we're educating our children.
Because, you know, Spike, the legacy of the little family is not in the movie at all.
No.
The legacy of the little family is not in the movie at all. Malcolm comes from an active family, right? And he was the last one to get it, you know. And so there's so many lessons in that, you know, in that, especially for those of us who do this work, those of us who are quote unquote conscious or black business owners or whatever, we all deal with the threat. I don't know if I should call it threat or the situation where our children may not get it. Our children may go another way, right? Or we may be gone because of the activism that we're doing. You know what I'm saying? And this showed that even though Malcolm grew up and he wasn't living the principles, he was a rebel, though. He was a rebel, like, you know, all day long. But when you're miseducated, when you rebel against society, it's often self-destructive. It's often a self-destructive rebellion. You know, so he didn't go to college. He didn't finish high school. He bucked the way you're a good man is supposed to go. He became a gangster. Well, a gangster is a rebel, too. Right. But he had something in him that other gangsters didn't have. And those were the core values that his parents had instilled in him. And when his sisters wrote in those letters, it activated something that was already there. Yeah. You know, it activated something. So we have to be consistent today in our homes in making sure our children understand the values that we believe in and that they see us walking in those values.
Yeah.
You know, that way, even if they stray, they have something to fall back into or to rise back into.
Yeah.
You know, so, and the Nation of Islam is the best reentry program for black men that has ever existed in America, period. Period. Right. And so there was an organization on the ground ready to receive him when he came out. You know, with the whole way of life waiting on them. This is what you eat. This is how you dress. This is how we talk. This is when we pray.
And And that was so vital for me. I'm thinking about young men in terms of reentry right now, and whether it be reentry from the military or reentry from the prison system, those places where that is the structure that they have known, where someone, there is a set structure around you to put them back out into a place that has no structure, that they have to create that structure on their own, usually with little to no guidance, and then, you know, become fathers or resume being fathers, it's difficult. So when you say that's the greatest reentry program that there's ever been, I think it's because it provides a similar structure that the system that they just came out of was providing, but now with a purpose.
Right. With a purpose and with new definitions, right? A new definition of what a man is that you didn't have before. A new definition of what God is that you didn't have before. And now the our new definition of a woman. And now these are empowering definitions.
Yep.
These are empowering. Oh, I'm God. I'm God. I'm a little G. Oh, I'm the maker, the owner, the cream of the planet Earth, the God of the universe. That's my attitude. That's what we own now.
Absolutely.
So affirming and empowering definitions in what you believe in and in what you practice, you know, and I think that's what a big part of the hook. A big part of the hook in African-centered education, a big part of the hook when it comes to engagement is Black history. It's sharing the culture in a way that affirms, sharing our story in a way that uplifts. Everyone wants to feel good about themselves. And when I feel good about myself, I do everything better.
Could you try again?
Look at Siri. I didn't ask you to say nothing.
It's not only feeling good about yourself, though, Bob. Mm-hmm. I'm not taking away from what you're saying, but I do want to add to it.
Go ahead.
I am of the belief that there is only one thing that changes behavior on a permanent level. Only one thing, and that is a change in your conception of who you are in the context of that thing. Right. So you can have a person who's used drugs forever, but then when they define themselves, I am a Christian, and that definition, they step into that and actually live that. Drugs no more. You don't have to say, you don't have to keep saying, oh, I'm an alcoholic. No, you replace that with, I'm a Christian, because inside of that is, or a Muslim, or whatever definition that you take on for yourself, and it is on a conscious level, it seeps down into your subconscious level, and you are committed to that defining of yourself, it changes how you behave because it gives you marching orders. And I find that in our school, the children who move towards African-centered thinking and the children who stay where they are in terms of just knowing that they Black children, but I'm not African. It's the end of the year. We have maybe 2 weeks left in school.
Mm-hmm.
I have an 8-year-old. We were watching a TV series on Black geniuses. It was a game show back in the day. And it's called Black Geniuses. There was another one. No, it wasn't called Black Genius. It was called Child Genius. I'm sorry. It was called Child Genius. And then there was another one. Just shows that I love competition. I love to watch. So I was teaching the children to be competitive. Right? There was one little Black boy and one little Black girl on the show. The other children were either white or Asian or India from the Asian continent.
Right.
And I'm hearing the comments from my students as they're watching the show. I had to turn it off because I'm hearing, I'm rooting for the white boy. I'm rooting for the white boy. Because he's going to win. He's the one that's going to win. So I'm hearing this. We pause the show and we say, okay, do you guys know what it means to be a genius? This is our first and second grade class. So they're Yeah, that means you're really smart. That means you know stuff that other people don't know. So they have an idea of what it means to be a genius. Do you have an idea of what the show Child Genius? Oh, yeah, that means you're born like that. That's what they're saying. You're born like that. This is what our children are saying. So then their teacher, Mama Brandy, asked, well, what type of babies are born genius? My little man, in June, almost June, end of the year, 2 weeks after school, we've been every day, African Center, African Center. He said, the babies with the beautiful blue eyes. So then we go deeper into it. And she said, okay, well, what type of babies have the beautiful blue eyes? And he said, well, the white babies, of course.
Right.
And then other students, mind you, that's 6, 7, 8.
Right.
Other students say, no, black babies, genius.
Come on. That's what I'm talking about.
They've gone back and forth and they start debating. So we have conversation. We press the play on the thing again. And this young man comes around to my desk and I'm working. He comes around to my desk and he said, Mama Cheryl, Why black people don't like white people? Why black people prejudice against the white people? Look at that white boy up there. He winning all the things. We should be like that. And I'm like, what have I done for 10 months? What have I been doing for 10 months? But here's the thing. The difference between him and the other children is that he will still say, I'm not African.
Mm-hmm.
And the ones who would beat him down to the ground, they'll tell you, I'm African, not just I'm black, but I'm African. We have them say a pledge every day that says I'm African, and we tell them what that means and the genius of Africans. We show them that all the time. But this young man and the family that he's from, and he's not the only one.
Right.
The ones who proclaim I'm African behave a certain way in the face of that type of thing.
Right.
And the ones who are still like, I'm black, I'm not African.
Mm-hmm.
There's a behavior that goes with that too.
Yeah.
So African centered education is vital, but only to the degree that they are redefining themselves in their own mind.
Right. Right. You know, my first thought when I heard him say, you know, like he said, he's not an African, you know, and you know, I'll be like, well, you sure ask questions like one. You might not be no African, but you sure speak up and speak your mind like one, because Africans speak their mind. You really African. I mean, you ain't got to call it that, but you keep speaking your mind like that and asking questions like that. You more African than most Africans I know. So you can call yourself whatever you want to call yourself if you're going to keep speaking up for yourself, because that's what I want you to do. Because once you realize who you are, ain't nobody going to take you off your square, because that boy already first, second grade, and he's defining who he is and who he ain't. That's intelligence. He's deciphering. He's questioning. He's saying, wait a minute, no, this guy, that was Malcolm.
We affirm them no matter where they are.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely affirm them no matter where they are, because they don't understand. So we circled up and we talked about it as an entire community of 50 children. And what came of it is, I never see white people doing bad things. I don't see it. When I see them on TV, when I see them on social media, But when black people on TV, social media, in my neighborhood, he doesn't see it.
Mm-hmm.
And we here walk a line between how much we show them of the atrocity, like for them to physically see it. We walk a real fine line. And in our homes, we don't let them see it either.
Mm-hmm.
And as children, If they don't see it, it's not real for them. These are people who just came out of playing hide and go seek, and they think if they close their own eyes, you can't see them.
Right.
So the question is, like, how much do we show them?
Okay.
So that they can see, like, this is what we're up against. I struggle with that. I struggle with that.
What you want them to see in the line you want to walk, right? Because what is an African-centered person, right? And your African-centeredness is not measured in any way. There is no metric, how do you feel about white people metric, right? Right. The metrics are, how do we feel about ourselves, right? And we're not worried so much about, you need to know that that's the enemy in first, like right now, you need to know that that's the enemy, right? They need to see more black excellence, and we just need to overload them with the black excellence. That other part is going to take care of itself, especially if you teach, because y'all teaching the story. And if you teach them the glory, like the thousands and thousands of years of African glory prior to slavery, right? And then when you get to the Ma'afa, you talk more about the endurance of our people, and you're introducing the Portuguese. We don't introduce white people. We introduce the Portuguese. We introduce the Dutch. We introduce the French. We introduce the English, right? And so you introduce these first five invaders of Africa, Asians, Arabs, Greeks, Romans, Northern Europeans, right? You start introducing these people in, and that's when their perception will start taking care of itself, because now I'm established as the hero. So this person being introduced to the story trying to enslave me must be the villain in this story, right? And so the story will take, and they'll start forming their own dynamics, you know what I'm saying, with that. I really love that you have a second grader that's questioning, that's asking questions and saying, now hold up, you know? And then now y'all sitting down and the children are saying, look, we're looking at this like a math equation. What I see every day is drama looking like this and greatness looking like that. You trying to tell me I'm just as great? So now you got to show me. You have to show me. And so when they're at that school for that 6 hours, 7 hours, they have to see. And that's what y'all been doing. That's what you're doing. That's what we do in African education. For those 7 hours, they're seeing black excellence. And that's why it has to be an overload of it. And it has to be taught from our perspective, so they can see it, you know, an overload of black excellence to try to help balance that out. Because they are up against a lot of anti-black media, anti-black sentiment, anti-black behavior, and behavior being perpetuated by black people. They see it.
Yeah.
We see it. You know, a lot of us as adults, there's a whole bunch of adults probably sitting in that circle being like, agreeing with that. yeah, agreeing with that. We're not fighting white supremacy. We're fighting black inferiority inside of African-centered education.
Absolutely. I understand that.
Yeah, we're fighting the feeling of inferiority. It's like, if I think I'm weak and a bully is pounding me on my head, you can remove the bully. That don't mean I don't still think I'm weak. The bully can stop, but I still have a complex.
That's why you got to whoop his ass one time.
You got to whoop his ass. You got to build something that he can't touch. You got to do something. But in order to do that, you got to get your mind right.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Before you can get him up off of you, you got to say, I'm going to either get him up off of me, or this is the end of life. This is just it for me. And you do it. But in order to get to that point, you got to feel like you deserve it, and you got to feel like you can do it. Right? In education, African-centered education, a part of it is making sure our children feel like they deserve it and they feel like they can do it. Because if you don't believe those two, if you don't have those two feelings internally, boom. And see, we want to make sure that with those who come and ask opinions like that, he may have an attitude that there's nothing I can't do, and what other people look like don't matter. We don't want to kill that, because they got to get out into the world, and we don't want them walking in every room, getting around white people, being uncomfortable.
Right.
if they got to go do business, they need to be able to walk in the room like boom and shake hands and talk business and get the deal done. We need this land. We got to go talk to them. Let's go get this deal done. We need this. If something's going over, let's go get this deal done. And we don't want them walking in like, you know, some of them got to be nuanced and know they need to know how to go in and boo, boo, boo. So we want their core values to be, yeah, there are certain situations where we ain't worried about the color thing. We ain't worried about the crayon box. Cause we got to get out here and we got to move, you know, but we know who we are. And we stepping in that, we walking in that, right? And that's what I love about the nation. Nation didn't run around, white down, they ain't running their face with it. You know what I'm saying? That's boom. They ain't let them in the meetings. We don't even want to hurt y'all feelings, white people. But over here, we talking about y'all. We talk about y'all like, woo, we talking bad about y'all ass. It's just a necessary piece. It's a necessary piece of the formula to really get you what you want. You want us gone? We gonna leave. We ain't gonna leave and starve. We want to separate. But in order to separate from you, I got to turn them against you first. Because we love you too much.
Yeah.
We love you too much. So it's only one thing that black people hate because we such a loving people. Only thing we ever hated was the devil.
True. That's why they had to be the devil.
They had to be the devil. Because we forgave everything else. We forgave everything else. And now we're getting tricked by sellout leaders that say freedom is spending your money in black, white hotels. Freedom is spending your money. So now you want to give them your money too? We love them too much. We love them too much. You lynch me, I ain't going nowhere. I'm going to live on this block. We love them too much. Right? They're like, okay, well, we're just going to re-enslave you. Here's some little peonage for you. Here's some vagrancy laws. So let me give you a little Jim Crow. We're going to burn them down over their own too much. We're going to bomb tough. You're going to forgive us for that too. There's only one thing they could be in the minds in order for that formula to work. This formula says we're going to build a nation of our own. We're going to separate. We're going to worship Allah. It's only one role white people can play in that story, and that's the devil. Only thing we hate, the only thing that we scared of going to the devil.
True.
We scared of going to the devil.
You got the hardest of the gangsters don't
want
to go to
hell. We talking, no, but we on church ground. We just walk across the churchyard. We stop cussing there. Don't even drink the beer. Don't hold the 40 right here. Then get past. You know, we quit lying. When you live, don't lie. You gonna go to the devil if you lie. You don't go to the devil. So it was only one thing we wanted to get away from. We want to get away from the devil. So if I convince you that the white man is the devil, then you gonna then come on, bring that money over here, bring your attention over here. We finna build school, we finna build bakeries, we finna build restaurants, we finna get to work. And get them out your mind. We the Nation of Islam don't protest. No, they weren't chasing white boys down the street. They weren't doing none of that. They were minding their own business. And by the time the hate that hate produced came out, that's why I stopped it right there, right? Because by the time the hate that hate produced, it was already tens of thousands of them just in New York. Just in New York. And white New York knew nothing about them. So, yeah. Yeah, we got to look at that formula and say, wow, they didn't kill nobody, ain't shoot nobody, none of that.
Yeah.
You don't hear a whole lot about, now they start having police confrontations with the Muslims, you know, in the early 60s, late 50s, early 60s, the issue with in LA and stuff like that. But the nation always had ways of dealing with that. And so it's a formula that you know, is worth looking at when it comes to educating in our community, you know, and revitalizing our community. So, yeah, man. Yeah. So the documentary is powerful, you know, and that first hour, I hope everyone learned something about Malcolm's early life that you may not have known. I do suggest that you get the autobiography of Malcolm X, but also read other materials on Malcolm as well. Definitely go and check out Make It Plain, the documentary. We're going to watch the rest of it next week. It's going to be about an hour and a half, though. So it's going to be about an hour and a half. I did good. I didn't pause the documentary one time. We watched it all the way through. So we're going to do it again next week, and we're going to discuss, you know, because what's coming up next is Malcolm's going to be at the height of his popularity. Then there's going to start being some friction between him and the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. There's going to be the split. There's going to be his pilgrimage to Mecca. It's going to be we're going to talk about the heads of state in Africa that he was talking to, and his plan to go to the UN and charge America with crimes against humanity. Bro's about to sue the whole United States, you know, and of course, we'll talk about his assassination and the impact beyond that as well, you know. I pray that you all are able to join us next week. I know they like them, but I'll be having them long broadcast. Look, I'm not, it don't hurt my feelings if you go eat and come back, catch it later on the replay. It is all good, right? But if we're going to talk about the negative content that's out here, let's balance it and make sure we create some positive content out here for our community as well. Cheryl, thank you for dropping in.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for letting me speak. I know I get long-winded sometimes.
No apologies, sister. You brought it, and you brought a sample of what we deal with culturally in African-centered education. And I think that's going to be great for other educators to look at, because you're talking doll test, basically. You're talking the doll test from Brown versus Board of Education, 1954. And we're talking about the same psychological impact. Right. Right. And so that's what we're going to do away with is the psychological impact of the myth of white supremacy. You know, in our children, they pick it up early, you know. And so parents, watch the media that your babies consume. All right. Watch the media, monitor the media that your babies are consuming, and make sure you're bringing balance into their minds and into their hearts. All right. So thank you for that example. Very powerful story. You know, you're transforming lives, Cheryl.
I'm planting seeds, if nothing else.
That's it. You know what I'm saying? But hey, be like the farmer. The farmer ain't worried about which seeds sprout. He just enjoys the process of planting. And so, you know, keep planting, and you water, fertile that soil. You know, your soil is healthy, you know, and then you control the environment. But hey, whatever's inside that seed is going to determine the result. All right. Thank you, Gail at Night. Again, if everybody go and subscribe to Gail at Night. Thank you for moderating, Gail. I really, really appreciate it. Another one of those just powerful, beautiful Africans that's out there doing positive things in this space. So y'all definitely check out Gail at Night. Man, the community is strong. The community is beautiful. The community is powerful. Y'all be good. Y'all be good. And empower another African this week, including yourself. All right. I'm out of here, y'all. Oh, go to uhuruacademy.com. I forgot to tell y'all, uhuruacademy.com to support the Uhuru Academy. And also wanted to real quick share. The first summer program that we're implementing this summer is the UACI Summer STEM Camp. All right. It's a collaboration between the Uhuru Academy and Conscious Ingenuity. Conscious Ingenuity being founded by Dr. Oya Mayat. Y'all know who Dr. Mayat is, right? And a lot of y'all may be checking Dr. Mayat's platform out on YouTube, which you haven't. You need to definitely go subscribe, you know what I'm saying, like right now, because she produces some of the best dialogues, man, some of the best dialogues on internet you can find on Dr. Mayat's channel. All right. But she's also an engineering professor at Morgan State University. right? And congratulations to her whole graduating class today. I saw the pictures, Doc, and she had the whole, she had a team. She had a team, about 7 or 8 strong Africans just got their degrees in engineering. So congratulations, Dr. Mayotte, and to all your students, right? But Dr. Mayotte has a program, and this is what we need our educators to do. She develops her own curriculum, her own programs, and she offers it up to the community, right? One piece of curriculum is her Mail Trek animated series, which is really cool. If you don't have Mail Trek in your library, you need to get Mail Trek, all right? You need to get Mail Trek. I'm talking about if you're homeschooling, if you're not homeschooling, whatever it is that you're doing. I believe you can go to edanime.com. I think you can go there, right? Ed Anime, it might be Ed Anime Productions. I would find out. Look up Mail Trek for me, Miss Gail. Look up Mail Trek for me, Gail. Right, check that. If you can find that and find a link to it, put it in here, right? But she has a Mail Trek animated series, a Black History series, Cheryl, that's off the chain. You know, it's a nice animated cartoon. Definitely need to have that in the library. But she's also developed the Conscious Ingenuity STEM program, and you can go to consciousingenuity.com. And let's see here. Okay, good. Put her links in here. Put her links in the chat. ConsciousIngenuity.com and check out the Conscious Ingenuity STEM program. Bring them to your school. Bring them to your home, to your community center. Go in there and let your community center know. Like, do y'all have Mail Trek in the library? Do y'all have Conscious Ingenuity curriculum up here available? Y'all doing any STEM program? Go to your public library and say, yo, Mr. Librarian, we want Conscious Ingenuity, and we want to make sure you got Mail Trek videos in the library. You know what I'm saying? So definitely homeschooling parents, Mail Trek, Conscious Ingenuity, check them out. So the UA Summer STEM Camp, UACI Summer STEM Camp, is a collaboration between Dr. Mayotte and myself from June 20th to July 1st. We're going to work with 30 young people, 15 on the UASC International Campus, and shout out to UASC International Learning Center here in Columbia, South Carolina. We're going to have 15 on campus, along with a graduated engineering student and Mr. Sean Gales, teacher extraordinaire, we're going to have 15 online, and we're going to have another intern online and another teacher online. And it's going to be a combination of Black history and STEM. So we have a curriculum that's called African History and STEM, where they're going to learn the contributions that our people have made globally in the areas of science, technology, engineering, and math, from the shaping of humanity on up. And we're going to do some academic enrichment as well, right? Working on their math and reading levels. And we're going to play games. We're very engaging. It's a lot of fun, right? And then they get with Conscious Ingenuity. And when they get with Conscious Ingenuity, they're going to be building micro:bit computers and learning how to program those computers and knowing the components, right? They're also going to learn basic coding, right? And some of you got babies that are already coding. They're going to love this camp because it's going to be project based. And they're going to learn the foundational principles behind machine learning, or artificial intelligence, or AI, as it's come to be known now, right? And so they're going to be exposed to different STEM careers, right? So this is going to be a fantastic camp. Go to uhuruacademy.com, all right, and right now, and check out the STEM camp. All right, now there is a tuition involved, and you see myself right there, and there's Dr. Mayotte, right, and there's definitely a tuition involved. Okay, it costs $400 per student, right, to put on the camp, right? Which it costs more than that, but a lot of things we do it in kind, and we're paying our interns, of course, for their time. There's curriculum materials that we need to order, that we have to get for our students, right? But when all was said and done, we said, you know what, we got this $400 right here. It breaks down to basically $40 a day, right? And you're talking a 4-hour day. So I'm like, we got this $400 here, $40 a day. You know what I'm saying? We'll charge that towards the community, right? But at the same time, we're looking for sponsors. right? We're also developing scholarships because we want to make sure that those who need it the most can get it, can get into this camp. I do not believe in allowing funds or lack thereof to get in the way. Right. So we're finding the funds, and that's the opportunity for black owned businesses to get involved. That's an opportunity for those of you who say, you know what, I'd like to sponsor a scholarship. I would like to be a part of introducing African children or enriching African youth involvement in STEM. Right. Black youth involvement in getting behind today's technology so they can build tomorrow's technology and learn how to learn technology in a way that benefits the community, benefits the earth, benefits humanity. There's a whole framework. We talked about framework earlier. There's a whole African-centered framework, the science, technology, engineering, the arts, and math, right? There's a whole African-centered framework there that will enhance their learning. And we want you to put your child, you want to put your child, especially that one that you know is into STEM, right? You definitely want to put them in this camp. So, and we're going to do everything in our power to make sure that there is no hindrance to signing up. Of course, space is limited, right? And so there are sponsorship opportunities available. Attach your brand to something great. Attach your brand to a movement that's building children. You know what I'm saying? To a movement that's introducing African families and black families to higher learning. Attach yourself to the Uhura Academy Conscious Ingenuity STEM Camp, right? And black people support black people that support black people. All right. Black people support black owned businesses that support black people, that support the black community. Let's forge a relationship, black business community. I believe the African centered education community and the black owned business community should be in lockstep. Number one, because we're black owned businesses ourselves. But number two, we build our institutions. Our institutions will produce the future workers and owners and receivers of legacy of your institution. What if your baby got school credit for working on the family business with you? How many black owned businesses end because the next generation don't want it? How many? A lot, right? And so what if we had a school system that recognized the generational importance of every black owned business, every business that we have in our community, right? And in that school, your child is encouraged and supported and you know what I'm saying? And your legacy, the legacy of that business ownership is reinforced. And they're actually given credit for embracing the family legacy. That don't mean they're going to be there, you know, when they're going to choose to do that when they get out of school. But if they make that choice, they'll know what they're doing. How many of you black business owners got an 18, 19 year old? Anybody? Like, how many of you black business owners have a youth between the age of 16 and 24 in your family that's working at your business, but don't really want to be there? They just there because they ain't got no money. Can't wait to leave and act ungrateful while they're there. And treat you more like you're doing them a favor than they, you know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, treat you like they doing you a favor. Yeah, they doing you a favor, you know, by they suffering while being there because they were not trained to want that. It runs counter to what they're seeing in school. It runs counter to what they're seeing in social media, that sort of thing. So they're like, nah, this ain't, I don't want this. But what if in the third grade, every day between 2 p.m. and 3:30 p.m., their class was family business. That's their class. And they have to do something towards the family business during that time. Now, if they virtual, they can be at the family business. But even if they're on campus, they can be off campus for that part. Right? So now you raise them, you're teaching them transferable skills within the context of their family legacy. Right? So the black business community and the African-centered education community, we need to be in lockstep.
Yeah.
We need to be in lockstep because we can develop one another, right? If you go to the site, that's the registration form right there, right? You got a tuition guide right there, and I'm just skimming through it, right? You can go check it out on your own, right? But if you become a sponsor, if you become a sponsor, if you invest in this relationship, right? If we invest, because when you sponsor, I'm investing. We're also putting our legitimacy on the line. And you're talking over 13 years of Uhura Academy working hard to build a good name in the community. So there's no amount of money, no amount of money that'll make us compromise our name and our values, right? But at the same time, we know that there are Black-owned businesses out there that are thriving, that have the same values that we do. We just need to get to know each other, right? So there are sponsorship opportunities, sponsorship relationship opportunities as well. You know, the Black tech community, the Black tech community, the Black AI community, cybersecurity community, the Black droning piloting community. We're your allies. We're your allies. We're teaching the next generation. Imagine a place where you have direct contact with, where you can go and share your skills and experiences. You can prepare the engineers of the future. You can, that's willing to work with you to prepare the Black coders of the future. Come talk to us. Some of you have ideas, curriculum ideas. Come talk to us. Right? And some of you just got it good. You got so much work and you turn and work away. Because every time I talk to somebody that Black that's coding, they're like, man, we've given away work, man. We have to, like, I mean, I'm in chat groups where I get so many jobs. People get so many jobs. We just be giving each other jobs. We just got to pass this off, pass that off. It's good. It's good. But it could be time consuming, depending on what you do. Right. But this sponsorship is for you. We need to put you in the sponsorship lane. Right. You got to write off some of that money anyway. You know, we're nonprofit. So this is the perfect nonprofit for a Black person in tech to support. Perfect. We want to empower you to create the next generation of Black coders, Black people in code. In coding, in cybersecurity, in networking, in cloud computing, in data analysts or data science. Right. And so definitely check out, go to the page and hit me up. Go to the page, hit me up, contact me. I need to put that box in there where you can do it right there. I need to put I'm interested in sponsoring fill in box right there. That's what I'm going to do when I get off this meeting, because y'all hit me up and let's talk. I want to learn, too. I want to be educated on how we can create a sponsorship relationship with the Black-owned business community that feeds both, that circulates, right? That builds lasting relationships, that circulates revenue, taps into the market of each business that we have a relationship with. Because I know, like Uhura Academy parents, they shop at businesses that support the Uhura Academy. That's like a part of our requirements. That's something we ask our parents. That's something we request. You know, I'm always on my parents too. Put your flyer in the group chat. Advertise your business in the group chat. Why y'all not advertising y'all business? I know you do this. You do fragrances and stuff, and you do shirts, and I know you do stock market stuff, man. Why y'all not advertising in here? Right? And so any business that we have a business relationship with, we're spreading the word. And we're supporting. Your success becomes my success. Right? So yeah, hit me up, sponsors. Hit me up. Empower us to be able to say tuition free. That's what I want to be able to say. I want next time we do the next camp, I want to go, no, not even next, even for this camp. It would be really cool if within a couple of weeks I could put a big old in bold on there, in tuition free, right there on the site. And making it tuition free is not as big a sponsorship as y'all think it is. To make it tuition free is not as big a sponsorship as you think it is. To make it tuition free, what are we talking? Yeah, I'll go ahead and say it. We're talking a $12,000 sponsorship. To make it tuition free. That's 12 people with $1,000. That's 12 people. It's 12 black. It's 12 people with $1,000. I know it is. Right? That's what makes it tuition free. 12 people with $1,000. 6 people with $2,000. 4 people with $3,000. It becomes tuition free. Now I can walk into an apartment complex here in Columbia and I can invite children out of the community that don't get to get out the community that much to come on our beautiful campus. You know what I'm saying? Come on our beautiful campus. We serve them a beautiful, healthy snack or healthy lunch. Come on our beautiful campus and teach them African history, help them with their math, their reading, and teach them STEM. Play games with them, show them the farm, boom, and their parents don't have to pay anything. I can get 15 students from across the country and across the water because we have students in Saudi Arabia, Africa, and in Europe now, right? And so with that sponsorship, I can tell them, boom, this is when camp is, and they don't mind. They'd be like, well, it's 2 p.m. where I am, but I don't care. I'm coming to camp. I can tell them it's tuition free. Come on. I have two new potential students in Ghana right now. And while we work out everything with the family, it will be really great if we can give them a scholarship to the STEM camp from Ghana. Give them a scholarship to the STEM camp so they can come and kind of test the waters, because they're going to come to Uhuru Academy full time in the fall because we're working on their scholarships. But I want to get a scholarship for them to come to the STEM camp. Why wait? Right? Why wait? Right. And so a scholarship for the African family is just $720 sponsorship. I mean, you know, yeah. Like if you going $720, I'm not even talking to you right now. I'm not even you can click off. I ain't trying to be funny. You know what I'm saying? But this ain't the part of the video. If you go back and study Louise Little. And watch the documentary again. All right. But anybody hanging out at this part, I'm about to slice this. I'm going to have my people come in and slice this end part off and give it its own video. All right. So definitely do that. Before I get out of here, and that's the STEM camp, y'all. STEM camp's going to be live. Now, last thing, before I get out of here, I got a shout out to UASC International. Make sure you go on to UASCinternational.org. Check out the most beautiful and fantastic African-centered campus I've ever seen right here in Hopkins, South Carolina, UASCinternational.org. We're having our sponsorship soiree. We're having our sponsorship soiree coming up. And let me pull that up right quick on my phone because I didn't pull it up prior. So let me pull that up right quick on my phone so I can see it and read it off to you all. Right. But we got the sponsorship soiree coming up. And I believe it's next week, but I'm going to get the specifics. Here we go. May 28th, right? May 28th, the Uhuru Sponsor Soiree. It's going to be at the hall at Senate's End. All right, right here in South Carolina. It's on I believe that's a Sunday, right? It's from 5 p.m. To 8 p.m., right? And this is our annual fundraiser at UASC. It's a banquet. Food's going to be delicious, all right? And there are also sponsorship opportunities as well. I'm going to put the link to this. I'm going to attach the flyer or something to this video You know, so it'll be on here. But you got the Uhuru sponsor soiree. Matter of fact, let me put this in the comments. Uhuru sponsor soiree, right? And it's going to be on 0528 in Columbia. SC. And then I want you to go and check out the tickets, get more information right here. Put that long link in there. Boom. All right, cool. All right, so I'll put that in the chat as well, and I'll go ahead and show it as well. But yeah, shout out to UASC International. It's time to endow that campus. It's time to get this campus an endowment where everything is taken care of. We ain't worried about salaries. We ain't worried about the land. Everything is taken care of, at least for the next 5 years. Okay, and that's the goal. Sure, when we put our campuses in the ground, we seek endowment. We seek enough support, resources, and funding to where we at least have a 5-year window to become self-refueling, to become as self-sufficient as possible, right? Because self-sufficiency is the goal. 100% self-sufficiency is the goal for any school that we build, right? But self-sufficiency isn't achieved overnight. Self-sufficiency is a process. It's not an event, right? And so we're looking for competent partners in that process, right? And get that endowment, you know. But an endowment is not just the money either. It's money that's attached to folk who know how to manage that money. You know, money attached to folks who know how to develop property, people who know how to deal with taxes and the whole nine yards. So not just the money, but the expertise and know-how. And then we have a team that's sitting there learning from this team that's already built an enterprise. How'd that go? Okay, show me. And so that's the type of relationship we're looking for. We're looking for some big brothers. African Center schools need big business brothers and big business sisters. Right? Yeah. But the goal is self-sufficiency. And the key is land, you know. And so, yes, we're going to be in the urban centers, but it's going to be where if we're in the urban center, we own the business complex. We're not renting from Mr. Lee, Mr. You know what I'm saying? We'll rent from a black owner, especially a black owner in the beginning. But the goal is always self-sufficiency. So we want to retire. So we find a black owner that owns a business strip. Our goal as a school is to retire him because we're going to buy this from you. We want to reward you. We want to send you home and decide whether or not you want to work again. We're going to buy this property from you. That's our goal, is to buy this whole thing. What's your number? What's your price? Right? Because then every school, then your school is like a real estate company. We're acquiring a future home of the Uhuru Academy, future home. We're looking for partners in that. We're looking for partners in that strategy. All right. All right. So that's what I got, y'all. That's what I got. All right. That's what we got coming up. Oh, I'll be in Texas real soon. We got the Uhuru Academy 2023 graduation and end of the year celebration, June 11th in Fort Worth, Texas. That's going to be fun. We're going to be graduating seniors from Uhuru Academy Online, and we're going to be graduating some young people from the community that stopped out of the school system, but they're getting their high school diploma through the Uhuru Academy. So that's going to be fun, too. That's going to be fun, too. All right. What new Akiva line got? When y'all last did school?
June 9th.
June 9th. Yes. Okay.
And then we have a summer camp.
Mm-hmm.
Not summer school. It's summer camp starting on Juneteenth.
Okay. That's what's up.
Yeah. Okay. So the camp it's about fun, but we, of course, put the academics in there. We're going to be doing a lot of academic competition.
Okay.
Mathletics, spelling bees, history bees, in addition to, it's Florida, so you know, we got to go swimming there.
Y'all in Florida, though, so y'all got to go.
just getting the children out into the community and exposed to things, but also educating them so that that summer slump of math and reading, it has been proven that over the summer, if your child gets no math and gets no reading, they will not, they won't have stayed where they were in class in their grade level, but they will actually regress. So we are giving it to them in a way that it's summer related and summer fun. We have a couple of other private schools, two other private schools that we're going to be competing against in math.
Really?
And spelling bees.
Oh, that's going to be fun. My students say they want y'all on the Black History Bee.
Okay.
Yeah, my students say they want some. They say they want some in the Black History Bee.
Okay.
Yeah. We just had one. With Sean Gales. He's a fifth grade teacher at the Katherine Johnson Academy in DeSoto, Texas. And he uses the Uhuru Academy model inside his classroom, right?
Okay.
And so they've been learning the history. So we put together a little 50 question Black History Bowl and had our little virtual competition. So we came into his classroom via Zoom. We had our whole classroom on there. Students got to meet each other and then they competed. It was really good. It was good. It was really good. But my now they want all the smoke with everybody.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, now they want all the smoke with everybody. But yeah. So, you know, and technically it was an international competition because we had our students there overseas in it and everything. So it was really cool. So we got to get new Akiba line in it, you know, in the mix. You know what I'm saying? And I think at the end of the year, every year, you know, or throughout the year, we have Black History Bowls.
Okay.
I'm with that. Let's make that happen. Yeah, let's make that happen. Sure. I don't know if let me see. Hold up. Let me see if this thing worked out. And check. I want to make sure that link is good that I put for UASC. Let me check my YouTube chat. Uh-oh, you couldn't find a page looking for this error. Okay, then why does that say? Okay, yeah. So, all right, y'all, I got to put that. I'm going to put the right link up in the chat. But, hey, we out of here. You know, I'm starting to smell food and stuff around me. And, I got to get myself in position. You know, oh, man. And we got to get ready for the week. All right. So last week of school, though, for us, though, you know, we always get out the last Friday in May. Yeah. Yeah. But it's report card time. So I got to go grade. All right. All right. I'm out, y'all. I see you. I'm out, y'all. Hey, peace and power. We done.
Good night, everybody.